अच्छा, इमूवेबल जॉइंट्स. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, वेयर वी डू वी सी सच जॉइंट्स? इन द बोन.
स्कल बोन, या द सूचर्स.
ओके, सूचर्स, वेरी गुड. द सूचर्स, वॉट एवर वी हैव, द इमूवेबल जॉइंट्स वेयर एवर वी हैव सच जॉइंट्स आर कॉल्ड एज फाइब्रस जॉइंट्स. लाइक वी हैव कोरोनल सूचर, लैम्डॉइड सूचर, सेजेटल सूचर, इजंट इट? So these are fibrous joints. Immovable joints, the which are found in the skull bone, are called as fibrous joints. Okay. Then do you remember Salsegere in the brain, beta? We discussed a lot, in fact, in our previous classes. Just checking the question paper. Salse, gyri and functional area of cerebral cortex. Question is very vague. And that too, it has come for short month. Okay. What are the sulci gyri you find on superolateral surface of cerebrum, beta?
Precentral, postcentral, lateral.
Yeah, very good. Basically, how do we divide the brain into four lobes? Can you name the main sulci? Central sulcus.
Middle temporal occipital, four lobes.
Name the four lobes.
Frontal, parietal, temporal, occipital lobes.
Okay, between the frontal and parietal, what is the name of the sulcus? Central sulcus.
Okay, okay.
Then, between the parietal and occipital, what is the name of the sulcus we have?
Post-central.
No, beta, parieto-occipital sulcus.
Achha, okay.
Parieto-occipital sulcus. Now, between the occipital lobe and temporal lobe, what is the name of the sulcus? Lateral sulcus.
Okay.
Lateral. Okay. So that means the three major sulci which divide the brain into four lobes, right? Frontal, parietal, and temporal. Okay. Now, here is your answer now. Basically, the brain has been divided into four lobes, like as Emma is telling us. Let me start. Okay, so it has central sulcus, which divides the brain into frontal and parietal lobe. Then there is, between the parietal and occipital lobe, there is a sulcus called as parieto-occipital sulcus. And between the temporal lobe and frontal lobe, we have one more sulcus, which is called as lateral sulcus. Okay, the parieto-occipital sulcus is actually not complete, as central sulcus is quite complete, because you can see our line is bold line. It goes and touches the lateral sulcus, whereas the parieto-occipital sulcus is not actually complete. We need to draw an imaginary line from here and move it towards lateral sulcus to make into parietal lobe. So this line is actually not existing. Just for our convenience, we extend this line. Okay, now there is one notch called as preoccipital notch. So when we draw one line which is running superiorly towards parieto-occipital sulcus, so the parieto-occipital sulcus line becomes complete. That means this is again imaginary line from here till here, from the preoccipital notch. This is occipital lobe, no? In front of it, you call it as preoccipital notch. And if you draw one line like this, so it comes and touches the parieto-occipital sulcus to make this lobe complete. That is occipital lobe. When you draw one line extending from parieto-occipital sulcus to lateral sulcus, so then you can make a subdivision between parietal lobe and temporal lobe. So that's how you divide the cerebrum into four lobes, frontal, parietal, temporal, and occipital. Now, coming to this picture, each lobe like frontal, parietal, occipital, and temporal will have certain sulci and gyri. When you start with the frontal lobe, this is the central sulcus. In front of the central sulcus, we also have precentral sulcus. Precentral sulcus. Then you have like superior temporal sulcus. This is one line, and then inferior temporal sulcus, one more line. This much you try to remember. Then the area between central sulcus and the precentral sulcus is called as precentral gyrus. Okay, the depressions are called as sulci and elevations are called as gyri. So area between central sulcus and precentral sulcus is precentral gyrus. Now we have two lines, right? Superior frontal sulcus, inferior frontal sulcus. Between them we have three areas like superior frontal gyrus, middle frontal gyrus, inferior frontal gyrus. Okay. Now when you talk, like what is the name of this sulcus I told you?
Lateral sulcus.
Oh, very good, Hema. From the lateral sulcus, if you draw these two lines, okay, this is actually called as horizontal ramus and this is called as ascending ramus. This will divide the inferior frontal gyrus into three areas. One, two, and three. Between these two lines, in front of this horizontal ramus, one area number one. Between horizontal and ascending ramus, area number two. Behind this ascending ramus, you have area number three. You call it as pars opercularis, pars orbitalis, and pars triangularis. So whatever I told you in frontal lobe, just to make it simple, you have a table. Just follow this. Frontal lobe. Sulci, depressions. We had precentral sulcus, superior frontal sulcus, inferior frontal sulcus. Area corresponding. Precentral gyrus. Above superior frontal sulcus, we have superior frontal gyrus. Below that, we have middle frontal. Lower to that, we have inferior frontal gyrus, which further subdivided by ascending and horizontal rami into three parts. What are those? Pars orbitalis, pars triangularis, and pars opercularis. Okay, this finishes frontal lobe beta. We should know where exactly it is. Then coming back to parietal lobe. This is parietal lobe, green in color. So in the parietal lobe, again, you have to focus on sulci and gyri. We know already this is central sulcus. Behind this, we have post-central sulcus. In between, we have post-central gyrus. Then you have this sulcus again here. You call it as like actually intraparietal sulcus, this area. Intraparietal sulcus. Now let us name the gyri. Behind the central sulcus, the area of the gyrus is post-central gyrus. This area is post-central gyrus. And above intraparietal sulcus, you have superior parietal lobule. Below that, you have inferior parietal lobule. Okay? So correspondingly, you check these names with parietal lobe. Okay? Now you should know which is the sulcus and which is the gyrus. Okay, then coming to temporal lobe, this is our temporal lobe. Here again you have two lines. Lines are sulci. Superior temporal sulcus, inferior temporal sulcus. So three gyri, superior temporal gyrus, middle temporal gyrus, inferior temporal gyrus. Correspondingly, you check in the table. Just practice this diagram and learn in the table. Your learning becomes very simple and easy. Then this yellow in color is occipital lobe. So in this occipital lobe, again, we do not have many sulci and gyri from this superior lateral surface. Okay. What is the name of this sulcus? We saw parieto-occipital sulcus. Okay. So here, the other sulcus you see is a part of this lateral sulcus. Half moon shaped sulcus is lunate sulcus. And this pole which is pointing is occipital pole. Okay. Then above this lunate sulcus, you have superior occipital gyrus. Below this, we have inferior occipital gyrus. Okay? So this is all about sulci and gyri, what you see on superolateral surface. Okay? Correspondingly, we are also asked now functional areas. This is actually looks like an essay question, which is highly impossible to write under 5 marks. Usually, such questions won't be asked, but to torture students, he gave a very much vague question. November 2018. November actually indicates, in fact, referred students also. Examiner was too much harsh with the students. Okay, beta. The functional areas, you better follow physiology textbook, beta, because their representation is quite easy. Or even this is good. This is pre-central sulcus, area number 4, post-central sulcus, area number 1 to 3. Okay, this is superior frontal sulcus, middle frontal, superior frontal gyrus, middle frontal gyrus, inferior frontal gyrus. You have area number 9, 10, 11. Pars supercularis, triangularis, and orbitalis. We have 44 and 45. Like that, post-central sulcus, gyrus, we have 3, 1, 2. So all these functional areas. Now area number, occipital lobe has 17, 18, 19 visual areas. Temporal lobe has most of the auditory areas. So just practice this diagram of functional areas, and correspondingly you need to learn this table. 100% it's an essay question, beta, but it is asked here. Okay. Suppose area number 4, that is motor area. This is area number 4. So pre-central gyrus and paracentral lobule. Our body's representation will be upside down. That means head is represented down and the feet are represented above. I will show you if it is given here. Generally in physiology, we have the body's representation. Yeah, yes, Peter, this one. Homunculus. So upside down in the sense head is represented down and feet is represented up. So this is our body's representation, whether it is motor area or whether it is sensory area. Everywhere our body's representation is upside down. Area number 4 is actually primary motor area controlling voluntary function. That means motor tracts are starting from here. Okay. Suppose if this area is damaged, you will see there will be contralateral paralysis. That means if right half of the brain is damaged, you will see left half of the body gets paralyzed. Okay. That is contralateral paralysis or Jacksonian fits. Similarly, you have like just look at the diagram where we have area number 6. Suppose this is the area number 6 in front of the precentral gyrus. Then what does it do? Like it is present in posterior part of superior middle and inferior frontal gyri. Location controls extrapyramidal system. If this is damaged, you will see we have lesions similar to pyramidal tract effects. Like that, you have this whole table and you need to follow this picture in order to know the functional areas, where they are situated, what is the function and what happens if it is damaged. Okay. So practice, though it is for essay here, it is asked for 5 marks. Okay, beta? Then, ligamentum denticulatum, recently I discussed. What are ligamentum denticulata, Hema?
Pia mater modification.
Extensions. From where till where?
I
don't remember.
I forgot the number, ma'am.
Okay. Ritika, Chavi, do you remember, beta? Ritika, so many times we have discussed, no, ligamentum denticulatum. Extension of pia mater from the spinal cord, it is moving to the vertebral foramen. That means it is going up to the bone. Okay. It looks like combed tooth. Okay, tooth, teeth of comb. Okay, that's how it is named as denticulatum. Teeth like projections, what we see from the pia mater, as though it is holding spinal cord in position. Okay, so that is ligamentum denticulatum, which has been asked for 2 marks. Let me check if picture is here. Let me show you. But it is given in Chaurasia picture. Somewhere we saw, no? Emma? It's spinal cord. I think in Meninges chapter it has been shown this. Meninges is this only. What did he show? Can anybody help me with page number of your book and share the image you have opened? Okay, anyhow, a 2 marks question. You just look into your books. Okay, then next we have ulnar nerve. Okay, how is ulnar nerve formed? Axillary nerve and ulnar nerve, 2 questions, and development of palate, that is embryology. Okay, how is ulnar nerve formed? From which cord of brachial plexus? Meghana. From the medial cord, isn't it? How many cords the brachial plexus have? It has 3 cords, no? Medial cord, lateral cord, and posterior cord. So from the medial cord, you have a code for MU. 1U is actually standing for ulnar nerve. The other U. Okay. Brachial plexus diagram we will see first. Then you will see a bit. See, this is brachial plexus, no? So here you have 3 cords. The one which is shown in green color is lateral cord. The one which is shown in violet color is posterior cord. The other green in color is medial cord. So from this medial cord of brachial plexus, you are finding one nerve. What is the name of this nerve? Ulnar nerve. So first part of the question is, how is ulnar nerve formed? Then you should tell it is formed from the medial cord of brachial plexus and its root value is C7, C8 and T1. Okay, C7, C8 and T1. Now when you talk about course of ulnar nerve, anybody remembers what does it supply? Hema? Chavi? Ritika? We have discussed many times, Beta, Ritika. Okay, but please tell me which muscles does it supply? Median nerve, ulnar nerve. Okay, now see here. Once it starts from the cords of brachial plexus, it pierces the medial intermuscular septum of arm. Once it pierces the medial intermuscular septum of arm, it comes and lies behind the medial epicondyle of the humerus. You can see this is the course of ulnar nerve. It comes to lie behind the medial epicondyle of the humerus. That's the reason when you just take rest on the table, when you take some jerk, you find there is tingling sensation because of the action of this nerve. That's the reason humerus is called funny bone, because this causes some tingling, some laughing type of sensation. Okay, so that is ulnar nerve's course. Once it is moving here, the ulnar nerve, what does it supply? Nobody remembers. Ulnar nerve, at least muscles. What are the muscles supplied by ulnar nerve in the forearm? Anyhow, in the arm, no nerve supply is there. It enters into the forearm. Okay. Once it enters into the forearm, it supplies 2 muscles. See, after passing behind the medial epicondyle, it has now entered into the forearm. It is running between these 2 muscles. Okay, what are those? Flexor carpi ulnaris and flexor digitorum profundus. Okay, flexor carpi ulnaris and flexor digitorum profundus. So it gives branches to these 2 muscles. Okay, in forearm only 2 muscles. One is the flexor carpi ulnaris and medial half of flexor digitorum profundus. Then it passes through flexor retinaculum. Then it enters into the palm. Chief nerve supply comes in the palm only. Isn't it? See, this is our ulnar nerve. And then you can see this is flexor retinaculum and it is passing here. And then it is entering into the palm. This is medium. No? So what is the distribution of ulnar nerve? This is purely, completely whole ulnar nerve distribution you can see. From the medial cord, it has come. It is running in the axilla. Okay. It lies most medial to all the structures like axillary artery, radial nerve, axillary nerve. Everything when you check, the most medial thing is ulnar nerve. It pierces behind the medial intermuscular septum. It comes to lie behind the medial epicondyle. Then it is entering in the forearm, supplying two muscles. One is flexor carpi ulnaris and flexor digitorum profundus. Then it is passing above the flexor retinaculum, entering in the palm, dividing into two branches, superficial branch and deep branch. Superficial branch supplies 1.5 digit, 1.5 digit. Deep branch supplies intrinsic muscles of the palm. Okay? Intrinsic muscles of the palm. Now, do you remember what are the muscles we have in thenar and hypothenar compartments? AFO is the code I told you.
Hypothenar is AFO.
Both are
I mean, what is supply? Hypothenar and thenar and intraosseatal supply and also lumbricals, two medial lumbricals it supplies.
Very good. Two medial lumbricals it supplies. Four dorsal interossea, four palmar interossea it supplies. Very good. And it supplies all hypothenar of muscles. Abductor digiti minimi, flexor digiti minimi, opponent's digiti minimi. And only one thenar group, that is adductor pollicis.
Adductor pollicis.
Okay, beta? So that is, if you practice, you will remember and learn more, beta. This is ulnar nerve. What happens if this ulnar nerve is damaged? Claw hand. Okay? Yeah. What happens?
Claw
hand. Needs to claw hand. Claw hand, beta. Okay? So there is last chapter called as appendix. Better you practice this diagram for ulnar nerve. You just check your page number in your textbook and you write the theory part from the table which is given in appendix of this textbook. Chaurasia, Vishram Singh, whatever you have, beta, up to you. I'm giving you the explanation. You can follow any book of your choice. See, this is the ulnar nerve injury. Superficial nerve is supplying 1.5 digit, no? Suppose if it is damaged, then it will lead to a claw hand. It will not involve these two fingers if it is ulnar nerve which is involved. Suppose if median nerve is also involved, then you will see complete claw hand. Okay. So look into the appendix for this answer. Okay. I'll show you once appendix from where to learn the answer. Make a note. It's quite easy. If you read and don't delay whatever answers I have discussed today, make a point to read it by tomorrow evening. Then only you can remember anything. Otherwise, again, you will be blank only. 100 times also if I teach and if you do not put your individual efforts, that is all waste. Better. This is also a nightmare. Okay. Unless you put your mind to learn something, you cannot remember the things. Better. My explanation may make your learning easy. But ultimate learning happens only when you start studying. Simply listening will not help you, beta. Please understand this. Simply listening will help you to make your target easy, but unless you read it for yourself, that's what is happening. I've been teaching you so many times, but still you are like unable to answer. That means what? Because of lockdown, you are taking things very casual, no? That's the reason. Okay, beta. See, this is ulnar nerve. You read it from here. Muscular branches, cutaneous branches. What are the branches in forearm? What are the branches in hand? What are the muscles it is supplying? Everything is given like a summary. And see, very simple. See, ulnar nerve starts here. Root value, how it is going in the axilla, in the arm, in the forearm. Very simple. Flexor retinaculum. Then it is distribution in palm and branches. And then applied anatomy. Okay. So this is appendix 1 chapter. You learn from there. So So one more nerve we have, axillary nerve. Okay, here we have axillary nerve. Axillary nerve is running in the axilla, isn't it? So from where does it come? From, again, it is a branch of posterior cord, ulnar, U-L-N-A-R. No, no, 4MU we have, right? So axillary nerve, our circumflex nerve is small terminal branch of the posterior cord. Posterior cord, what are the branches we have with posterior cord? LML is lateral cord, isn't it? Lateral pectoral nerve, then musculocutaneous nerve, and lateral root of median nerve. Then posterior cord, what is the cord we have? Ulnar, upper subscapular, lower subscapular, nerve to latissimus dorsi, axillary nerve, and radial nerve. A is actually standing for axillary nerve. Okay, that means it is coming from posterior cord. Try to remember the root value, C5, C6. Okay, if you have remembered that quadrangular space, which is bounded by teres minor, teres major, okay, and the shaft of the humerus, and the long head of triceps, it is actually running there in the quadrangular space along with the branches of third part of the axillary artery, profunda brachii vessels, anterior circumflex humeral and posterior circumflex humeral. It's better I take you to that picture only. It becomes easy for you. What are the muscles supplied by axillary nerve? Deltoid
and teres minor.
Okay. So you can write the course from there only. This is triangular and quadrangular spaces. Where do we find that, beta? Page numbers. Yes, this one. I was talking about, see, this is our axillary nerve. Okay. So this is axillary nerve supplying teres minor and deltoid muscle. This is teres minor, this is deltoid. These are the four boundaries. Very short course it has. As soon as it comes from posterior cord, it runs in the axilla, it gives a twig to teres minor, it gives a twig to deltoid. Okay? If this nerve is damaged, deltoid would be paralyzed and we will not be able to make abduction 90 degrees. Okay? The boundaries are like superiorly it is teres minor, inferiorly teres major, medially long head of triceps, laterally surgical neck of humerus. Okay, beta? So read. And development of palate, because I don't have embryology textbook right now, we will discuss in some time else, at a time we will discuss. Okay, beta?
Yes,
so we'll stop here.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Bye, beta. Read, but like, yes, it disappoints me when you don't answer.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, beta. Bye.
Good night.